good morning. I want to just welcome everybody and say happy Easter. We're so glad that you are worshiping with us today. Before I jump into the content for today, I want to mention a couple of things. First of all, I want to remind you that we have baptisms at the end of the service. We had six people make a decision last night to be baptized. Five of those decisions were spontaneous. So that was an awesome thing at our first service. Yeah, celebrate those guys. Sure. We actually had somebody attend for the first time. They were just here for the egg hunt, and one of our greeters said, well, why don't you go on into the service? And so they were like, went on into the service, and they made a decision to get baptized. So that was just a really cool experience. We want you to know that if you're here today, you may not even know this, but you might be getting baptized at the end of the service. And so I do want you to know, to be thinking about that. If you have not been baptized as an adult, as somebody who can make that decision for themselves, we want to offer that to you today. We do have people getting baptized already during this service, and at the end of the service, we have a team that will take you to our changing rooms, and we've got shirts and towels and t-shirts and shorts and everything that you need to get baptized. So just be thinking about that if you haven't made that decision. Second thing is, before we get started with today's message, I want to talk about next week's message. Every once in a while, we do just sort of a series that's just a lot of fun. And we're going to be working through the book of Ephesians over the next 4 weeks, and we're going to be focused in on how bizarre it is that Christ has called us to be. So we got a kind of a freak show coming. It's going to be carnival themed. It's called Bizarre. We're going to focus in on how different Christ has called each of us to be, and just to have fun with that. So we're going to have kind of a fun element one week, and the next week, my favorite element we're going to have, this is just fun, we're going to have a funnel cake truck here next week, and that's just close to my heart. Just, there is nothing to celebrate better on God's green earth than fried donut bread, right? That's just, and then you put that glaze on it there, and my children, or that, you know, I love my kids. So anyway, just want to encourage you, don't just come to church, but come back next week. It's going to be a good series, like it's going to be really good, but it's going to be a lot of fun too. So today we're talking about, of course, Easter. And here's the thing, I just to be transparent, I've been in full-time ministry for 17 years, which means, I did the math on this, that means I've done 17 Easter services. Yeah, I did the math. It took a little while, but I figured it out. Anyway, so here's what happens. Every Easter rolls around, and it's the same content, right? Jesus rose from the dead. It's the greatest thing on earth, but it kind of gets a little old hat for the preacher. Like, what am I going to talk about this week? And I don't want to just like reheat some message from 5 years ago in the microwave and give it to you. No, like, I want to say what, you know, God wants me to say. So this past Wednesday, I did this thing that I do every Wednesday. I just went, God, what do you want me to talk about Sunday? Because regardless of what our plans are or what we're talking about, what do you want me to talk about? So I just started praying, and this phrase popped into my head. Is the phrase eternal life. Just two words, eternal life. Now, it's not like that's a new concept. I've talked about eternal life before. I've studied that even in Scripture, but I was like, you know what? I'm just going to go pop that into BibleGateway.com. You can do this. It's a little free resource. It's a really cool thing to do. I just popped that phrase in there, and I searched every time in the Bible that the phrase eternal life is mentioned. I read through every example, and I got through the New Testament, and I was completely struck with this thought. The number one reason given for why you should believe in Jesus, the number one reason given why you should persevere when things are tough, the number one reason that you should endure temptation and remain faithful is eternal life. That is the major motivation given to us in the Bible. Now, here's what struck me about that. That's not how you and I think. We don't like our hope suspended. We don't like it a long time from now. We want it today, and we want it this week. We want it now. I'll give you an example. If I were to go home today after church and I were to turn to my kids and be like, hey guys, if you guys go home and clean your room, we're going to go to Disney World 2 years from now. My kids would be like, okay. And if I just walked out of the room, they may not clean their rooms at all. Even though the promise of Disney World is at hand, they probably wouldn't even do it, because that's like 2 years from now, right? But if I were to go home and Gabe be like, guys, if you go clean your room in the next 15 minutes, we're going to Krispy Kreme! They'd be like, woo! And they'd go clean their rooms, and we'd be in the car driving down the road because we love us some fried bread with some glaze on it. I think I've mentioned that before. Anyway, we like our gratification immediately. We like our hope immediately. We want to know what Jesus can do for us right now. And so here's as a default, here's what we do. As preachers, as Christians, and I'm as guilty of this as anybody, we try to sell you hope today and right now and this week. And we come across with this message, man, if you just give your life to Jesus, like, he'll fix all your problems and everything that worries you and every stress you have and every anxiety and money problems, and God's gonna fix this and you'll be all brand new by Friday. And that's not what the New Testament says. The New Testament says, here's your hope. Here's where you want to place your hope. You want to put your hope in something? Don't put in what, man, I'm going to be obedient to God and then God's going to reward me tomorrow. It doesn't work like that. I'm going to be obedient to God. I'm going to do what God's going to do. And here's what God's going to do. He's going to give you eternal life. In fact, you know what the Bible says? For people who have put their faith in God, not just people that acknowledge that there's a God, but people who have placed their faith in Jesus, who believe in him, those people, for us, eternal life has already begun. It's already started. We're already on the trip. It's kind of like when you're going to Disney World or you're going on that big vacation, right? And you're at the airport at 4 a.m, right? Doesn't feel very fun. Hasn't really hit exciting. You're not taking a picture with Mickey yet, right? But you're already on the trip. For those of you who believe and have put your faith in Christ, we're already living eternally. We're not going to experience what the Bible calls that second death. It's the offer of eternal life. Let me show you what I'm talking about. John chapter 5 says this about eternal life. Very truly I tell you, this is Jesus. Very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. That is the hope that we have when we believe in Christ. Let me give you a bunch of different examples. Romans chapter 2, 7 says this. 1 John 2 says this. As for you, see what you have heard from the beginning remains in you. If it does, you also will remain in the Son and in the Father, and this is what he promised us. Eternal life. Romans 2, 7 says this. To those who by persistence in doing good seek glory, honor, and immortality, he will give eternal life. John chapter 6, 27, he says, do not work for food that spoils. That's what you spent your whole week doing. You worked for some fried bread that spoils. So do not work for spoil, but for food that endures to eternal life. John chapter 4:14, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. Romans 2:6-22. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. John 3:16, you might have heard of this one. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. One more. Galatians 6:8. Whoever sows to please their flesh from the flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit from the Spirit will reap, say it with me, eternal life. Man, Jesus died on a cross and rose from the grave so that you and I could live eternally forever in paradise with him. Man, if that doesn't want to cause you to be celebrating something today, I don't know what will. And here's what we are told to do in Scripture. We're told to take our hope, our faithfulness, our obedience, our calling, we're taking our hope and we're to place it in that eternal dwelling that will last forever and ever. But the problem with you and I is we make more plans for this week, this month, this year, and this life than we do forever and ever. We make more plans in this life. We are more vested in our vacation that we're going to take next year or this summer than we are in the reality of eternal life. You and I are more focused on our retirement than we are eternal life. Let me tell you how your retirement's going to go. You're going to save your whole life for it. You're going to be excited about it. You're going to hope one day you're going to actually retire. And then when you actually retire, you're going to be old and you're going to hate it. And you're probably going to die a lot younger than you think you are. You might even end up in a hospital. Just bank on it, okay? Eat some fried bread. Try to shorten that retirement window. That's my plan. No, we plan more for retirement this last 10, 15, 20, 25 years of our life than we do for the next million. Forever and ever and ever. And I got to tell you this, the New Testament doesn't make any sense without eternal life. The hope that Jesus gives us doesn't make any sense. The entire Bible doesn't make any sense unless it is in the hope of eternal life. So here's what I want to do today. I want to take your hope, and I want to place it not in what God's going to do in your life this week, not what he's going to do in your life this moment, but what he's going to do eternally. To do that, I want to give you two pictures from the book of Revelation. There's two pictures that start this revelation in the book of Revelation. There's two pictures. The first one is the throne room of God. God's throne room is Revelation chapter 4 and 5. And we look at this picture, we look at this image in Revelation 4 and 5, and we see God on his throne. Now here's the thing about this picture. It's not what's going to happen, it's actually what's happening now. The difference is, right now, you and I have to believe that by faith. We have to believe that everything that's happening in this world is okay because God is on his throne, and you and I have to believe it by faith. But one day, when we're out of this world, when our time's up, we'll be able to look and just see the reality of God on his throne. So here's what I want to do. I want to show you this picture in Revelation chapter 4 and 5. I love these two chapters. I can easily say these are my favorite two chapters in Scripture. I love them so much that several years ago, I memorized them just to know these two chapters. And like nobody else does this, but sometimes I'll just drive down the road and I'll quote Revelation 4 and 5, okay? So if you ever just see me driving down the road, and I'm just driving down the road like that, and I'm just talking Revelation, that's what I'm doing, okay? I'm not crazy, okay? And sometimes when I pull up to a stoplight, I pull my phone up to my face. So it looks like I'm talking to somebody, but I'm like, holy, holy. Anyway, but I want to give you this picture today, and I love this picture, and if you've never heard it before, you've never read it before, you've never seen it before, I got to tell you, there's some things you're going to hear that you're going to be like, what? What is that? What's going on there? Don't get lost in the details. Just stand back and see this picture that John paints as he saw the throne room of God. Looks like this. Revelation chapter 4 and 5 goes like this. After this, I looked, and there before me was a door standing open in heaven. And the voice I had first heard speaking to me as a trumpet said, "Come up here, and I will show you what must soon take place after this." At once, I was in the Spirit, and there before me was a throne. And the one who sat on the throne had the appearance of jasper and of carnelian. A rainbow resembling an emerald encircled the throne. Before the throne were 24 other thrones, and seated on them were 24 elders, and they were dressed in white, and they had crowns of gold on their head. From the throne came flashes of lightning, rumblings, and peals of thunder. Before the throne were seven lamps blazing. These are the seven spirits of God. Also before the throne was what looked like a sea of glass, as clear as crystal. In the center before the throne were four living creatures, and they were covered with eyes in front and in back. And they each had six wings. The first living creature looked like a lion, the second like an ox, the third had a face like a man, and the fourth like a flying eagle. They each had six wings, and they were covered with eyes all around, even under their wings, and day and night they never stopped saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Whenever the four living creatures give glory, honor, and thanks to him who sits on the throne and who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and who lives forever and ever. They lay their crowns of gold before him and say, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory, honor, and power, for you created all things, and by your will all things were created and have their being." And I saw on the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writing on both sides and sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and its seals?" But no one in heaven or on earth was found worthy to open the scroll or even look inside. And I wept, and I wept because no one was found worthy. Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, he has triumphed. He is worthy to open the scroll and its seals." And I looked, and there before me was a lamb, looking as if it had been slain, standing in the center of the throne, encircled by the living creatures and the 24 elders. He had seven heads and seven horns, which are the seven spirits of God. He came and took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. And when he had taken it, the living creatures and the elders fell down before the Lamb. They each had harps, and they were holding golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song. "You are worthy to open the scroll and its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased men for God from every tribe and language and nation and people. You have made them to be a kingdom of priests to serve our God, and they will reign over the earth." And then I heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000s times 10,000s. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the 24 elders, and they sang in a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and honor and glory and praise." And then I saw every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be glory and power and honor and praise forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the 24 elders, they fell down and worshiped. And that is the throne of my God. That is a picture of what is happening right now. Our God is sitting on his throne. Man, what a throne it is. And we're sitting around worried about our taxes. We're talking about retirement. We're worried about the most insecure, petty things you can imagine. Well, if I break up with him, will I be alone for the rest of my life? God's sitting on his throne. We're worried about weird little people like Kim Jong-un, guys like Vladimir Putin, what Trump's going to do or what Trump's not going to do. We're worried about it. Like our God can't handle it. Like he's not in control. Like he doesn't know everything that's happened at this point in his life and everything that's going to happen. We're worried that maybe God doesn't have this all figured out and God's just sitting on his throne. I can just imagine this. Just imagine that every nation in the world got together. Even the United States. Trump and Putin, they're kind of friends anywhere here. And Kim Jong-un, and all of a sudden there's this miracle where they all come together and they're just like, you know, we're going to work together. And ISIS joins together and every nation on earth joins together and says, you know what, we are going to attack heaven. We're going to attack God's throne. What do you think that would look like? With every nuclear weapon, with every military mine, with every tank, with every weapon, with every soldier, attack heaven, what would that look like? It would be the definition of a fart in the wind. That's what it would be. Like God would just be standing there, and Michael would hear this, and be like, what was that? That was everybody on earth just attacked heaven. That's what that was. That's the throne of my God. And I got to tell you, one day when my time's up, right? When my life is over, when my retirement has finished, when I no longer walk this kind of sad earth, I'm going to stand in heaven and God's going to dress me in white. And he's going to give me this crown, and I'm going to be standing next to some crazy, jacked up looking creature with eyes all over his body and six wings. And I'm going to sing. And I can't sing, but I'm going to sing. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. That, for those of us who believe in Christ, who are following him, is our reality. Isn't some fairy tale? Isn't some story? Our life is eternal life, and everything that we do here has the hope of eternal life attached to it. One day we'll stand and we'll see what the reality is right now, that God is on his throne. The second picture I want to give you is the end of the book of Revelation. So the revelation to John starts in chapter 4 and 5, and then it ends at the end with Revelation chapter 21 and 22. It's this picture of the new heaven and the new earth. This picture that we often don't focus our minds on enough. I want to give you this picture. I do not have this one memorized, so let's read it. Revelation chapter 21 goes like this. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. Let me stop there. That's important. A new heaven and a new earth. Now let me tell you why that's important. Because if you've never really looked through this from the Bible's perspective or God's perspective, then you don't know that there's actually something really wrong with the earth. Right? Because it's all you've ever known. And because it's all you've ever known and it's all you've ever really thought through, you look at the earth and you go, yeah, it's got problems, but you also, you're an optimist. It's a good thing. I'm an optimist too. You look around and you say, but the earth is filled with so many good things. And so we focus on the goodness of this world and we talk about how good things are. And I do that too. And there's good things on this earth. Trust me, you know? And so you might find them. You might look and go, oh, it's my family. I got a wife and four kids that are the source of constant joy in my life, right? I love that. I see joy in that all the time. There's some things in this life to absolutely enjoy. There's fried bread, right? There's everything you can imagine. You look at it, you might think that thing, oh man, the earth is just such a wonderful place, and you might go, yeah, it's wonderful. And so you might be one of those people that when I say, hey, how you doing? You're like, well, I'm alive. And you're presenting that to me like it's a good thing. I'm like, oh, really, as Christians, we should walk around and be like, how are you today? Well, I'm still alive. So how do you think I am, right? But no, you're happy to be alive. You're happy that you're walking around because you think of that as a positive thing. Now, I get that. But listen, if you know the Bible and if you put on these faith goggles and you believe and you view the world the way God views the world, then what you find is when you look at the world, it's a really sad place. It's not supposed to be like this. It's broken. And when I say broken, I mean like it's really broken. Like there's a thing called sex trafficking that we have to deal with. There's poor, there's poverty, there's death. You know, you're not supposed to go to funerals. You're not supposed to know that feeling of what it's like to stand next to somebody that you loved, your spouse, your kid, your brother, your sister, your father, your mother. You're not supposed to know that feeling of standing right next to them and feeling this heartache like I don't know what to do now because they're gone. You're not supposed to feel that. It's broken. The world is broken. And I know this. I know that no matter how much I follow God in my life, no matter how faithful I am, no matter how obedient I am still going to feel the hurt and brokenness of this world. And there is a person that I love more than anybody else on this earth, and it is my wife. And one day, either I'm going to stand by her casket or she's going to stand by mine, and we are just going to ache because this world sucks. But God says this, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. It continues. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. You ever see that baseball game where you're standing there, and they bring this little girl out on the field, and you don't know why she's out there, and all of a sudden the mascot comes up beside her, and they're videoing it, and all of a sudden the mascot pulls off its head, and it's her dad who's a soldier, and he's come back. He's come back in, and all of us are like, oh my goodness, and we can't contain it because now the dad is being reunited with her child, and we don't know anything about that dad. That dad might be an absolute jerk, right? We don't know. He's just back. That's all we know. That little girl might be crying because, oh no, daddy's home, right? We don't. We don't know anything about that situation, but just the concept that this little girl who hasn't had her dad for months or years or however long is now reunited with her father in just a very, very, very tiny, itsy-bitsy, teeny way, you can kind of see what it means that we are going to reunite it with our dad. That God is going to make his dwelling with us. He's going to live with us. He's going to dwell with us. We're going to be back together, and that's a feeling that we have never experienced before because of the sin in our lives and in this world that separates us from God. But one day, he's going to dwell with us. And it says he will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be more. Next verse. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. If you want a motivation to live for Christ, if you want a motivation to be obedient, if you want motivation to endure temptation and be faithful to God anyway, if you want to put your hope somewhere, put your hope in this, that one day you will see God on his throne and that you will live forever in a new place that God has prepared for you. Maybe you're out there today and you've never made the decision to believe in him. You're just sitting out there going, yeah, I guess I believe in God and stuff, but you've never said, you know what, I'm going to figure it out. Maybe you don't even know what that means. And the decision you need to make today is just, I'm going to figure it out. This is way more important than my retirement, my taxes, my family. This is more important than anything. I got to figure out what it means to follow God, and I'm gonna put my faith in him today. Maybe that's a decision you're just going to make right now where you sit in your heart. Maybe that decision looks like coming back to church next week. Maybe it means going home and opening the Bible. Maybe it means research. Maybe it means surrender. But you're going to make that decision right here and right now, and the reason you're doing it, because you want the hope and the promise of eternal life. Maybe for some of you out there, you've kind of taken that step and you believe and you put your faith in God, but you really haven't crossed over the line. Like, you haven't told anybody. You haven't made it public. It hasn't become your new identity. And you know the thing that you need to do today is make that decision to get baptized. And you need to just jump out in front and just be like, hey, not only am I going to get baptized, but I'm going to like post it on Facebook. I'm actually going to tell people. I want everybody to know I made the decision to believe in God. I'm going to surrender my life to him. Maybe that's the decision you need to make today. Or maybe you're killing it. Like, you have faith. You've had faith for a long time, and you're learning, and you're growing, and it's been difficult, and God's weeded out some things in your life, and you're learning to trust in him more, but you're a faithful follower today. And maybe just what you need to do is you need to be filled with hope. And you just need to take it up a notch, and you need to know that there is no reason to ever be discouraged by anything that you see in this world or anything you see in anybody else's life, but you just need to be encouraged and put your faith more in God and take it up a notch. Whatever it is that God's calling you today, do it. Don't hold on. Don't put it off. Don't wait. Respond to God. Let me pray for you.